right. Good to see everybody here this evening. Let's get started. Take your songbook and turn over to 361. 361, Heavenly Sunlight. 361, Walking in Sunlight, All of My Journey. Let's stand together to sing it. 361, Brother Bob.
Walking in sunlight, all of my journey, over the mountains, through the deep veil. Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee. Promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises. Jesus is mine. Shadows around me, shadows above me. He is a light, in him is no darkness. Ever I'm walking close by his side. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises. Jesus is mine. In the bright sunlight, ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above. Singing his praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine.
All right, good singing tonight. Good to see you in church, and plenty of sunlight in today. And yesterday, doesn't seem like September 21st. Is this the first day of fall? September 22nd. And only supposed to be 87, I think, tomorrow. And cooling right off for us, isn't it? But how many of you like fall weather when it's actually here? And but it is cooling off in the evenings, and that's nice. But it's still a beautiful day. Good to be in church tonight. Glad you made it. And let's open with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we thank you for this evening. Thank you for another opportunity for us to gather together here. And Lord, thank you for each one who's made their way to church this evening. And Father, we're asking you now to meet with us and do a work in each one of our hearts that you desire to do. Pray that we'll be yielded to you to listen carefully and to your still small voice of the Holy Spirit as he ministers to our hearts tonight. Bless the music. Bless our fellowship together. Honor the study of your word tonight. And Father, I pray for the other classes, the children as they're meeting in the building. Lord, I pray that you'll bless them this evening. Open their hearts to the word of God. Give them a passion and a desire to please you. May you have your way, Lord, in our midst tonight. And I'll thank you for what you'll do, for we do ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, you may be seated.
Let's go to 149 together, 149, because he lives. God sent his son, God sent his son. They called him Jesus, he came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future. And life is worth a living just because he lives. How sweet to hold. still. That calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because he lives, because he lives. I can face tomorrow, because he lives. All fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and life is worth a living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory, and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because he lives. All fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and life is worth a living just because he lives.
Good evening. This evening's missionary message is from Evangelist Larry Smith, entitled Prayer Letter, Fall 2016. Decades ago, God put a desire in my heart to travel and preach and help pastors and churches. I never sought it. Pastors started calling me in early 2000s. I was teaching at Hiles Anderson College at that time, and I loved my work. I taught soul winning and Bible. Dr. Schaap generously allowed me to travel and preach a certain number of days a year. The Holy Spirit led me into full-time evangelism in 2005, and I've enjoyed these years immensely. A desire fulfilled. Connecticut. A long-time desire was fulfilled last weekend. I was privileged to preach for Pastor Dan Cahan. He and Miss Carrie Soule were married in Texas, and I was privileged to fill his pulpit. I spoke on finances, Holy Spirit fullness, and soul winning. The altar was well used morning and evening. Lighthouse Baptist Church has as fine a people as I've ever met. His two local sons, Will and Joe, flew to Texas for the wedding Saturday morning and were in their places serving on Sunday. Will and Joe are as fine young men as I've ever met. Lenny Nelson Funeral. Estelle and I attended Pastor Nelson's funeral while in Connecticut and were blessed by the testimony of his life, his wife, siblings, and four daughters. Their singing of "We Will Never Say Goodbye in Heaven" as the casket was taken away was moving. The testimony of the spiritual depth of his wife and daughters was a blessing. The man who hit Pastor Nelson on his motorcycle was led to Christ by a Nelson brother. Praise be to God. Estelle and I got up at 2 in the morning for a drive to O'Hare Airport. I gave one of our helpers at the airport a pictorial tract and said, "This will tell you how to know for sure you will go to heaven when you die. You'd like to know that, wouldn't you?" She replied, "Yes." In a few minutes, our heads were bowed. I prayed and thanked God for her and asked him to save her. Then I said, "With our heads bowed, God is looking from heaven above. If you would like to receive Christ, pray this prayer out loud with me, out of your heart, only if you mean it." She prayed and rejoiced, having had her sins lifted at 4:30 in the morning. Amen. Amen. Two others received Christ recently at McDonald's. A mother and son received Christ. God is so good. The kitchen table is the best place to win souls. A man called me from Miami, Florida. He said, "I asked my pastor how to get rid of my sins, and he would not tell me. Apparently, this is a Christian church. I looked on the internet and called you. It was not long until Jose was rejoicing in the Lord with his sins gone. Thank God for the saving grace of Jesus. Thank you. Your prayers for Mrs. Smith and me are absolutely appreciated and needed. 10,000 times over, thank you to all those who support us. I carry your names in my shirt pocket and pray for you and your work often. There are many needs, and your prayers asking God to meet them are deeply appreciated.
Brother Smith, appreciate him so much, and continuing on for the Lord every week, every week, every week, every week. Remember that? Some of you weren't here. You don't know what that is. But those of us who remember him preaching our missions conferences, we remember that. I got a letter here from the Inman family, who were just in our conference. In fact, they're down at Heritage Baptist Church in Canal Winchester for their missions conference now, and Brother Yoder's down there preaching that conference for them. And they left a note here for us. It says, "We are at the end of your incredible missions conference, and wow, are we grateful for you and your people. Thank you for treating us so special and for taking great amounts of time to learn of us and encourage our work for the Lord. The people at Bible Baptist Church made it extremely easy to feel comfortable and to just have great fellowship times full of enjoyment. Thank you for the beautiful Prophet's Chamber, of which your people spent much time to make luxurious. We appreciate so much the multiple meals, of which were scrumptious with great variety, along with the time and care placed into each item. Thank you also for the beautiful decorations throughout the fellowship building and within the church building. It is a meticulously kept property. My kids love the zoo, and so did we. Thank you for taking us there, and thank you also for including us in your parade. It was pure pleasure representing your church, driving the float." He was the driver. And he said, "Sorry if the float moved too quickly." "We were blown away Saturday night to see the time, effort, and expense placed into purchasing every item and more that was populated on the spreadsheet. We have already arranged low-cost barge shipping to make sure everything is utilized in the best of ways for many years in Thailand. We thank you for being such a blessing and encouragement to us through your people's giving of gifts and showing their heart for missions to the point that we walked away feeling like family. Thank you for strengthening us through the preaching of Brother Cobb and the fellowship with the many saints in the church. It is a blessing to see so many reaching out with compassion to the needs of people here in the Columbus area. We thank you also for your child-friendly church and church family, of whom my kids had an amazing time with. Pastor, we will always remember our time with you in Bible Baptist Church. The whole week was a great learning experience, especially in the areas of patience, giving, and missions. We'll be praying for you and your church as you continue to reach this area and many around the world through worldwide missions. We'll continue to keep you posted on our progress and the work that the Lord has done here and abroad. May the Lord continue to bless you richly in the coming decades. Your friends in Jesus, the Chad Inman family." Isn't that good? Wanted to share that with you. That was a real blessing to have them. And they stayed for a couple days since they were just going down to Canal Winchester. They stayed over a few days, and they had a good time here. All right, get your prayer guide out if you would. Anybody need one? Anybody cared for? All right. Coming events, of course, be in prayer for the missions conference down in Canal Winchester and Brother Yoder as he preaches the messages there each evening. And also remember, Friday, I believe it is, Ann Moreland flies in. Ann and Grace come home. So be praying for safety for their flights. 23rd, is that right? Do you know, Heather? Yeah, which is Friday, our time, 23rd. So be praying for them. They'll have a safe flight home. And then, of course, the RU Inside tomorrow night at the prison, and then Friday night here, Saturday morning at London, Saturday morning for our soul winning and bus visitation. Don't forget the teens have an activity from 4 to 7 here at the church on Saturday. And then Sunday, we'll see Brother Hector Jimenez here. I think they'll be here all day, but I'm going to ask him to bring the message Sunday evening so you'll get an opportunity to hear him preach. You'll really enjoy Brother Hector and his family. And then remember October 1st, the hayride and bonfire at the Mannings. And I think the bus is planning to leave at 4 from the church and be down to London there. to the farm a little before 5. Remember, if you remember, we have to shuttle the people back to where we're having the fire on the hay wagon, so it may take a couple trips to get everybody back. All right. Praise reports. There was no service at the CRC this past Thursday because we had our missions conference here, and so we did not have our you down there. They had 16 at London on Saturday, and of course the great faith promise offering there, that's a promise for the coming year, tremendous. And by the way, that is that amount, based on that amount, we had a number, I don't know how many. Ms. Taylor, do you have any idea how many were at $35 a month? 14. We have starting next month, we'll raise all of them up to $50 a month. So now all of our missionaries will have 50, and the Morelands and the Yoders, we give more than that because they're ours, and we go a little more than 50 for them. But everybody will be at 50, and the day will come, I'd just like to see them go on up to 75 a month and get on up to where everybody gets 100 a month, amen? And that would be great. So we'll praise the Lord for that. When we came 10 years ago, they had missionaries at $25 a month and weren't always hitting that. So God's been good to us, amen? And we praise the Lord for that. Continue to pray for these on the health list, if you would. And want to remember, especially there at the top, Paula Ross. I visited with Paula today. Prayerfully, she's doing much better. And prayerfully, they're hoping on best case scenario, maybe within a couple weeks, she'll head to a rehab facility, hoping to get one in Grove City right here on Monterey on Hoover Road, and do some rehab there. But she had a bowel obstruction that ended up rupturing, bursting. And it was really, it was pretty tense there for a while. So pray for her full recovery, if you would, and she recuperates from that. And she's in room 719 there at Mount Carmel West. Okay? And, of course, we pray for these in authority in the upcoming election particularly. And then we pray for these in our military, and pray for these who are battling cancer, and these on our salvation list. The unreached people groups for this week, and continue to lift them up in prayer. And then, of course, our missionaries, highlighted tonight by Evangelist Larry Smith. So let's go ahead and we'll get ready to go to prayer. Brother John Polable, I'd like you to come on up if you would, and I want you to lead us in our prayer tonight. Yes. Okay. Jill Brooks, Doctors West. Okay. Got it. All right. Brother John, you lead us in prayer tonight, please.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that you've given us where we can come to the church and worship you, and we ask that you'd be with the pastor tonight now as he brings a message, that you'd fill him with the Spirit, and if there's one here that does not know you as Lord and Savior, that tonight would be a night with when they come to know you as Lord and Savior. And we do thank you for the free gift that you've given us of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And we thank you for our missionaries that are out in the United States and in foreign countries. We just pray that you'd put a hedge about them, keep the evil one from them, and we ask that you'd help them now, give them the wisdom, the knowledge that they need as they preach the Word of God in the kind of these foreign countries, because there's so many things that they have to look out for, and the people. So we pray that you'd help them and give them the wisdom they need, and we pray for those around the United States that you'll best bless them, and that they'll be able to get their money coming in faithfully each week. And we do pray that you'd help them also, that you'd give them the wisdom and knowledge they need. And then we pray for our military that we have that are around the world and foreign countries watching over us as we are here tonight, and also throughout the week. There are 24-hour services all the time. They're always on the job. So we thank you for them. We pray that you'd help them. Pray that you'd guide them from the evil one, keep them away, and also watch out for them. And we pray you to give them the knowledge that they need as they serve you. And we thank you for that. And we pray for those that have cancer. We pray that you'd be with them and letting them know that you're there and from your presence is there, and that you would will help him through this situation. And we do pray for the one on our salvation list. We just pray that someone would come across their path, and that they'd be ready, and that they would be willing, and that they'd be able to take it, listen to what the person has is dealing with them. And we pray that they'd get saved and know you as Lord and Savior. And we do pray for those on our prayer list here, the health problems, and we pray for this one that they just put on tonight. We pray that you'd help her, that you'd be with her throughout the evening, and they'll find out what's going on, and they'll be able to help her. And we do pray for the others, that your perfect will be done in each one of their lives. And we pray that you'd help them now through this time, and we ask that you'd continue to watch over them. We thank you for the number that we have that are going, we're going to receive as far as the missions, and we thank you for that. And thank you that we're able to raise them up to 50, and then, as like Pastor said, to raise them up to even 75 or even 100. But we pray that we'd have to wait on you, and pray that you'd continue to give us that we need, and also the missionaries. And we do want to thank you for this RU group that we have part of partial support of on Thursday nights and on Fridays. And we ask that you'd help us now. And on Saturday also, praise would be with them, and praise you continue to help those men as they are studying their lessons and doing the things that they are supposed to do. And we ask that you would help them now through this time and get them back on their feet and get them back home to their loved ones soon. And we ask that you'd continue to watch over the church now, and pray that you'd bless the offering that we take tonight. And we praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Two hundred twenty-eight in your hymnal, 228. Would you turn with me? And stand as you find, He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. Let's sing that verse together. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of His love, and make somebody feel welcome. We'll come back and sing that last stanza together. Thank you. hide my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hide my life in the depths of his love and covered me there with his hand. And covered me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise. Let's sing that last together. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with a million on high. He hided my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hided my life in the depths of his love and covered me there with his hand.
Be seated if you will. Ushers will come and get our offering now tonight. And tonight, the Reformers Unanimous in Rockford has had a very unique opportunity. The Philippines have of course, I don't know of a place that doesn't have a drug epidemic, but they have, the government there is really made an unprecedented move, and they've appealed to the churches of the Philippines to help them with the addicts and to help them with the drug problem. And so right now they have between 750 and 1,000 Bible preaching churches in the Philippines that want the RU program and want to institute it there. You imagine what 1,000 churches, could impact that could have with the addicts there. Now it's $250 to start up the RU program for them in the Philippines. They have the material, and he says once they get it going, the churches will sustain it. But they were asking local chapters here in the U.S. if they would sponsor getting a church started with RU over there. And I told Brother Bob, we want to challenge our group on Friday night to do that. But I thought maybe we would help with that as a church. And maybe we could maybe not just sponsor one, but maybe two to get this going over there. What a blessing that'll be. And it's exciting. And it's great. You know, just like when the reception center here came to us and said, can you bring the faith-based program in? We realize what we're doing isn't working. And their eyes are opening up, and this is really an amazing opportunity. And so we want to help. So we're just going to take the offering tonight, and we'll put it towards that. If you don't have something tonight and you want to give towards that, you can put it in on Sunday. That's okay too. And I think it'd be exciting. And that's one of the exciting things of heaven as well. We're going to meet people that you supported, or missionaries reached, or that this program reaches in the Philippines, that we won't really know the results till we get to glory. And then we're going to see some things, and what a day that'll be. And so let's give towards that tonight, all right? And we'll pray and ask God's blessing on the offering. Brother Taylor, I'll have you pray for us tonight.
Dear Father, Lord, we thank you for another day, Lord, that you've given us. And thank you for being here with us. Yes. Father, we do thank you that we have an opportunity here to bring a gospel teaching program for the lost and the needy, Lord. We know that it goes far deeper than just Reformers Unanimous. It goes into the heart of man. And that's the only way we're going to change it. Lord, thank you for giving us an opportunity to give to that program again. It might help others, Lord. Father, as this offering is taken, may it be pleasing to you. Be with us tonight, Lord, as the pastor opens up the lesson. Help us all to be attentive, Lord, and hear what you would have us to learn. We thank you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Take your Bible, go to Ephesians chapter 6, please. Ephesians chapter 6. We have discussed the first 2 weeks of our study in spiritual warfare about the battle against the flesh and then the battle against the world. And tonight we'll talk a little bit about our spiritual warfare with the devil. And we'll talk, going to identify a little bit who the devil is. And you find out, you're not saved very long till you find out we have an enemy. And the enemy is the devil. Notice Ephesians 6 and verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Now, Father, we bow before you as we come to open up your word tonight. And God, we're asking for your help in opening our understanding as we look into your word. I ask that the Holy Spirit would help us and guide us, and he would be the master teacher here this evening. Lord, you help us to rightly divide the word of truth, and help us, Lord, tonight as we look at who our enemy is. Father, I pray that we would understand him and understand his tactics and his strategies. We would understand how it is that you've given us the victory, not only over their flesh and not only the world, but over the devil as well. And so, God, guide our study tonight and put a hedge of protection around this place. And in the name of Jesus Christ and by his authority, I bind Satan from this place. And he's not welcome here, or any of his demons, any of his followers. Protect us tonight, God, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, we have an enemy, and the question always comes is, well, where did the devil come from? And we're going to learn a little bit about our enemy this evening. Now, we'll actually get into some issues and some battles that people may have and may have issues with as we get into our study next Wednesday night, actually against the hierarchy that's mentioned in verse 12, when he talks about not only the devil, but there's principalities, there's powers, there's rulers of darkness of this world, there's spiritual wickedness in high places. The devil has a kingdom, and we'll talk about that a little bit this evening, and you'll understand a little bit who the devil is. You know, the world goes to great lengths, and the devil is behind it, to let us think that he's no big deal, or that he doesn't even exist, or that he's something to be laughed at, or you know, he's got a red suit and a pitchfork, and you know, excuse me, and we can just laugh at him. It's no big deal, and you know, the comedy thing of the devil made me do it, and And so we want to minimize that, and he would want us to believe that. But that's not the true picture of the devil. So let's learn a little bit about our enemy here this evening. Number one, I want you to notice his beginning. His beginning. And for that, you go back to the Old Testament, to the book of Ezekiel. And I want you to look at Ezekiel 28. There's two places that talk about Satan when he was created. He wasn't called Satan then. He was called Lucifer. And here in Ezekiel chapter 28, beginning in verse number 11, he's going to talk metaphorically here about the king of Tyrus, but you're going to see that he's really talking about Lucifer, all right? Verse 11, the Bible says of Ezekiel 28, verse 11, "Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, Thou sealest up the sum, full of wisdom, and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering. Sardis, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, the carbuncle, and the gold. The workmanship of thy tablets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude of thy merchandise they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings, that they may behold thee." So here we have the beginning of what was called Lucifer. You notice he was full of wisdom and beauty. In fact, he's called in this the perfection of beauty, the seal of perfection. That's it's hard to comprehend that with our mind. He was given a place on God's holy mountain, verse number 14. With the very presence of God. He was created a holy and a righteous being. Verse 15. Perfect in thy ways thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. And what was it that caused his fall? Pride in his heart. Pride. His heart was lifted up because of beauty. And so we see he had an incredible beginning. An amazing beginning as God created him to be one of the angels that would be in his presence. Now, the second defining place in the Bible that you go to learn about Satan and his, or Lucifer at that time and his creation, besides Ezekiel 28, is you take half of 28 and what do you have? 14. You go to Isaiah chapter 14, okay? Isaiah chapter 14. So go to your left a little bit. Go past Jeremiah. You'll see the next big book you come to is Isaiah, and you go to Isaiah 14. Isaiah and Ezekiel speak about the fall of Satan and his creation. Number two, here Isaiah talks about his rebellion against God. His rebellion against God. Notice Isaiah 14, verse 12. "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart," now notice the I wills, "I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. I will be like the Most High.
I will, I will, I will, I will. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. So he wanted to make himself equal with God. Notice, he's saying, I will sit, he said, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north. The city of the great king. That's God's place, Psalm 48. And I remember that because I remember how to sing it. And but that's God's place. What he's saying, I'll take the place of God. I'm going to be like God. And so he rebels, and that leads to God judging him. Thou shalt be brought down to hell to the sides of the pit. That's his rebellion against God. So that's his beginning. And that's his rebellion against God. That's how it all began. And he's cast down to the earth. Now, when you first meet him in Genesis, all this has already happened. And he's been cast down to the earth. And he's in the garden with Adam and Eve. Now, he's called the serpent in Genesis 3. But it doesn't mean that he's the serpent as we picture a serpent now. That happened after the fall. And God cursed him, the serpent, to slide on its belly the rest of its life. So apparently up to that time, it was not a slithering, slimy little creature or big creature that you picture when you picture snakes or serpents. He still possibly could have maintained some of that beauty that he had, that he was created with. And so he's very pleasant to look at and very easy to have a conversation with. And of course, there's several names given to the devil that reveal to us a little bit and are a lot what he's like, okay? Let's look at some of the names given to the devil, and I want you to use your Bible tonight, okay? So look at these scriptures with me, and of course we know, first of all, verse here in Isaiah 14, verse 12, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer? That was the original name of him when he was created, and that's interesting. You know what Lucifer means? It means light bearer. Light bearer. Now, why is that important? Because in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, 2 Corinthians 11 and verse number 14. In fact, to get the context, let's back up to verse 13. Because Paul says, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel. For Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. He's got that angel of light, and he still has that ability to transform himself to be an angel of light. So when somebody says, well, I had a vision, an angel appeared to me, you better be careful. That doesn't necessarily mean that's an angel of God. That could be an angel of light that's an angel of Satan. It's always interesting to me when you think about this, and as I was preparing this, I thought about the numerous people who've had the out-of-body experiences, you know, or they thought they died, and they said, and every one of them, I just heard one a week or so ago, talked about, they don't talk about Jesus, they don't talk about eternal life, they talk about the light. And I was moving towards the light. And you know what's difficult? It's difficult to ever witness to people like that, who've had that kind of an experience, because they're counting on the fact that that was the light of heaven. But that may have been the light of Satan, to deceive you. Nobody's going to heaven because they saw light. You're going to heaven because you know Jesus Christ is your Savior and you're trusting Him alone for your salvation. That's the only way you go to heaven. And it's awful difficult to get somebody to be saved because they can't believe they're lost because of what they've experienced. And so you have to be careful because he can be transformed into an angel of light. Then, of course, Luke 22,
and verse 31. Luke 22 and verse 31, when Jesus addresses Simon Peter. Luke 22 and verse number 31. The Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. Now the word Satan means adversary. The adversary would have you that he may sift you as wheat. And he is a constant and relentless opponent. He never gives up. He's Satan. Then the Bible calls him in Revelation 12 and verse number 10, it calls him the accuser of the brethren. Revelation 12 and verse 10, he's the accuser of the brethren. The Bible says, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. He is always accusing us to God. And by the way, though he's a liar, and we'll come to that, and he doesn't tell the truth, it doesn't say he's a false accuser. He is accuser of the brethren. He just continually to throw up our faults, our sins, our shortcomings, and he'll throw them up. By the way, he accuses us to God. He accuses, and we'll talk about this again later, I think, but he accuses God to us. Yeah, some God you serve. If God really loved you, he wouldn't let you go through this. God really loved you, he wouldn't let this happen to you. You see, he accuses God to us, then he accuses us to God. Come on, you saved that guy? Look what he's doing. You saved her? Look what she just did. You know what I mean? Man, they can't be your child. And he brings those accusations. He's accuser of the brethren. And by the way, so when you begin to accuse other believers and you become an accuser, be careful what company you're in. You're in bad company. All right. Then he's called, and also in chapter 12 of Revelation, verse number 7, he's called the dragon. It says there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought in his angels. Again, he's referred to the dragon, and of course, verse 9 says, the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. That's the dragon. Then, of course, we know here in Revelation 12:9, also in 1 Peter 5:8, he's called the devil. The devil. The word devil means slanderer. He's a slanderer. He just defames us and slanders us. And again, he'll defame and slander God to us and defame and slander us to God. That's what he loves to do. Now, I want you to look at John chapter 8, the Gospel of John chapter 8. Will you turn there, please? John chapter 8. Boy, I like Bible study, don't you? John chapter 8. Here, Jesus is speaking to the Pharisees, and they're trying to tell him that we have Abraham as our father and not you, and certainly not God. He's saying, if God, verse 42 of John 8, if God were your father, you would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. Ye are of your father, who? The devil. And the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. So here he is. What is he? He's a murderer and he's a liar. What a great father to have, huh? He's a murderer and a liar. Just over a few chapters, John chapter 12, verse number 31. John 12 and verse 31, Jesus says, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out." Here he calls him the prince of this world. And he's a powerful manipulator in the world. Manipulates people and manipulates these events to take place. He's the prince of this world. Ephesians 2 and verse 2. Ephesians 2 and verse 2. Notice what the Apostle Paul here refers to him as, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He says, "Wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience." The prince of the power of the air. So that tells us something, that he moves in the atmosphere that surrounds the earth. Okay? He's the prince of the power of the air. We can't see it. We don't have the spiritual sight to see it. But if we could see all the spiritual activity going on between God's messengers, God's angels sent forth to minister for God, and Satan's demons and their activity in there, we'd be amazed at what we see goes on and the conflict that takes place. Revelation 9, verse 11, he's called the destroyer. If you're filling your paper out, J there is simply, he's called the tempter. He's called the evil one. He's called the God of this world. 2 Corinthians 4:4. The God of this world. When you think of the pride, when you think of the lying, when you think of the murdering, when you think of the deceiving, when you think of all those things, and then you look at what's in our world today, he's the God of this world. And his children act like their daddy. That's what's going on. Now, let's go to number 4 in your paper, and that is the Satan's power. Satan's power. Remember what we referred to in Ephesians 6, verse 12, about principalities, powers, and he has a kingdom. He has a kingdom that he's built, that has been established. Revelation 2 in verse number 13 tells us he also has a throne. It's a seat that he sits upon. We read earlier in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 that not only can he become or transform himself to look like an angel of light, but that his servants will pretend to be servants of righteousness. False teachers who will pretend to be true teachers. People that'll have enough truth that people will fall for it and believe them, but they're teaching heresy. They're teaching lies. And they're teaching lies about God. And people don't even realize it. So he has a kingdom, he has a throne, he's more powerful than the mightiest angels. And we get that mainly from Jude chapter 9. And in Jude, and not chapter 9, Jude verse 9, there's only one chapter in Jude, but Jude verse 9, "Yet Michael the archangel, while contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses. He durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, The Lord rebuke thee." Michael having a disputation about, and something about the body of Moses. Now, we don't know if you remember, nobody knows where Moses got buried. God had that private burial by himself. But there's some kind of a battle going on there that Satan was trying to get to the body of Moses. And Michael was protecting that, but Michael couldn't overcome him. He had to invoke a name mightier than his, and he said, "The Lord rebuke thee." And that's an important lesson that we'll come to later on. Don't forget that. So he's more powerful than the mightiest angel. But listen, we also know this. His power is limited by God. How do we know that? Job chapter 1. He had to get permission to touch Job. And God gave him the permission, and then all his surroundings, but then he came and had to ask permission again, "Let me touch his body." skin for skin, a man will give everything for his own life. But God, and God had that much confidence and that much trust in Job that he said, go ahead. And boy, the boils came and the pain and the agony they went through. And yet, what did Job say? Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Well, that isn't what Satan expected. That isn't what he was looking for. And so we realize that he's powerful, but he's limited by God. God has to allow him to be able to work on the believer. Now, number five on your paper there, Satan has a place of operation. Where's his place of operation? Right here on earth. The passage, if you remember, in Job chapter 1, when he came to present himself, I'm going to look there real quick for you. Job chapter 1. The Lord said unto Satan, from whence cometh thou? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it. That's where he is. 1 Peter 5:8, Satan's like a roaring lion that walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. He's right here. Years ago, back in the 70s, I think it was, didn't Hal Lindsey write the book, Satan's Alive and Well on Planet Earth or something like that, was the title of it. And it's been 40-some years, but he's still alive and well on planet Earth. And we see that. So he operates here on the earth. Now, let's talk about his devices and his strategies. Devices and strategies. Paul tells us in Corinthians, we're not to be ignorant of his devices. You ought to know how he operates, because then you can recognize what's going on. You can recognize who's behind it. We know that, number one, he tempts man with sin. That's what he did in the Garden of Eden in Genesis chapter 3. Tempted Adam and Eve to go against what God clearly said they should not do. And he'll tempt you to sin. Well, you say, how do I know whether God's testing me or Satan's tempting me? If it's a temptation to sin, to go against the commandment of God, to transgress the commandment of God, that's not God. God does not tempt any man with evil. He won't do it. Okay? So that's how you know whether it's a test from God or whether it's a temptation from Satan. There's no ever a temptation to sin when God's involved. We know, this is interesting, look at Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. And we'll open this up a little more in the weeks to come. But this is an amazing verse, because he causes sickness and suffering. Notice John 10 or Acts 10 and verse number 38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of who? Of the devil. For God was with him. He was had to bring healing to some people. What was the source of their healing? They were oppressed of the devil. We'll get into oppression and possession and those kind of things, I think, next Wednesday night when we get together. But he's behind a lot of the sickness, a lot of the oppression, the things that people have. And by the way, we have more things plaguing people today than ever before. They have to make up names to figure out what's going on with people. And sometimes people get things and they still don't know what's wrong with them. It's an amazing thing that's going on. But that's from Satan. Then we also find this. Look at Hebrews chapter 2. Would you turn there with me, please? Hebrews chapter 2. Did you know that Satan has the power of death? The Bible says in verse 14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil. We know that from the Gospel of John, he comes to kill and to steal and to destroy. Say, can the devil kill people? Absolutely. Absolutely. The amount of, I believe oftentimes when a person despairs and gets so far into depression that they take their life, Satan's behind that. He's the author of that. He's destroying their life. When, as soon as those demons went out of the maniac and went into the pigs, what'd the pigs do? Committed suicide. But they went right over the cliff, and down they went, and it was destroyed. All right. Then we know from 1 Timothy chapter 3 that he tries to ensnare people in traps. In 1 Timothy 3, it's giving the requirements for the office of the pastor. And it talks about that he should not be a novice in verse 6, lest being lifted up with pride, he'll fall into the condemnation of the devil. But moreover, verse 7, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. So we know the devil puts snares out, lays traps to capture us. John 13 and verse 2 tells us that he can put wicked thoughts into our hearts. He puts wicked thoughts into our hearts. John 13. John 13 is talking about Judas. The Bible says in verse 1, when the feast of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father. Having loved his own that were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Put it in his heart. Another time you see this taking place is Acts chapter 5 with the Ananias and Sapphira in regards to the giving. Peter said to Ananias in verse 3 of Acts 5, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Why did Satan put that in your heart? See, he's able to do that. That's why the Bible says we bring every thought into the obedience of Christ. And if it doesn't come up what we know to be true about God, we cast it out. We don't dwell on that. We get rid of that thought. See? And we don't keep it. All right? Then we know that also in John 13, again, if you're still there, he can personally enter in and control a person. And that's what happened with Judas Iscariot. The Bible says in verse 27, after the sop, Jesus gave whoever dips in this bowl with me is the one who's going to betray me. He says, after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then Jesus said unto him, that thou doest, do quickly. I don't think Jesus was talking to Judas. I think he was talking to Satan. He knew that Satan wasn't done yet, and he was going to try to keep him from going to the cross. What else does Satan do? Look at Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. Are you all right? Doing okay? Mark chapter 4. Mark 4. This is the parable of the sower. You're familiar with this. When verse 15, when Jesus explains the parable here, he says, these are they by the wayside where the word is sown, but when they have heard, who comes immediately? Satan does. And what's he do? Takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. Satan does that every single church service. Every single church service. Word gets sown in your heart, and I tell you what, you'll get in the parking lot, and whether it's something you turn on the radio, or whether it's you get home and turn television on, or you see a billboard on the way home, or you talk to somebody else, and boy, right away, he'll snatch it right out of your heart. He's still using that strategy. Something else he does too, Matthew chapter 13. Matthew 13. Here he's talking about the wheat and the tares. Jesus is explaining the parable to his disciples. And he tells them in verse 38, the field is the world, the good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world, the reapers are the angels. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be at the end of the world. So what happened? The wheat and the tares are growing together. Where are Satan's followers? They're right among the wheat. Where are Satan's followers? Some of them are in church. And some of them are in church to cause trouble in the church. And just to be a problem in the church. You have to be aware and be on guard. And then, you know, Satan can also hinder God's people from carrying out God's desires. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. The Apostle Paul made a statement here. He's telling the church at Thessalonica in verse 18 of chapter 2, wherefore we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. He opposed us. He kept us from doing what was in our heart to do and what we'd like to do. Haven't you ever, hey, you've experienced that to some degree. You know that many times your work days go great except for Wednesday. Yeah, most days, you know, whenever the whistle blows, whether it's 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock or 4:30 or 5:30, whatever it is, you know, man, you're ready to go out the door except Wednesday. Someone will show up and want you to do something right at the... You know what I mean? It'll always work that way. Or there'll be a wreck somewhere in the highway. And everything will be backed up. Why? Because you're trying to get to church. That's why. You have to understand, we try to get this through to our you people. You know what I mean? Because they'll talk about this happened on Friday or that happened on Friday. Why do you think it happened on Friday? What do you think? Somebody's trying to hinder you from doing what you know God wants you to do. And you have to realize that's our enemy. That's our enemy. So listen, look at that list. He tempts us with sin. He can cause a sickness and suffering. He has the power of death. He ensnares us in traps. He can put wicked thoughts in our heart. He can personally enter in and control a person, not a saved person. But he takes away the word of God from understanding. He puts his followers among God's followers, and he can hinder us from carrying out God's plans. And we were too tired to get up and read our Bible. We think we're going to take this on. We think we're going to fight just him, let alone all his angels, his demons that work with him. We think we don't need any kind of protection. We think we don't need any spiritual armament. No wonder the devil has such an easy time with us. Now, you need to know this, and we got to hustle, don't we? Satan's judgment. Satan's judgment. You can just look these up as I fill the blanks in for you. He's under the sentence of doom. Jesus, remember the passage in Isaiah 14? Thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. That's going to happen. He's under an unending curse. That's from Genesis 3, 14 and 15. A prophecy there. We know that during the earthly reign of Christ, that 1,000-year reign, he'll be bound for 1,000 years. And the world will be an unbelievably different place for 1,000 years. No presence of Satan, no presence of sin. And then eventually, he will be punished eternally in the lake of fire. Revelation 20. Not enjoying the lake of fire, not having a beer party in the lake of fire, being punished in the lake of fire. Now, I want you to look at a couple verses here. Look at Colossians 2 and verse 15. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Colossians 2 and verse 15, and then over to 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. 1 John 3 and verse 8. Notice Colossians 2 and verse 15. The Bible says, and having spoiled principalities and powers. Now, wait a minute. What was the kingdom of Satan again in chapter 6 and verse 12 of Ephesians? Principalities and powers. Jesus spoiled them. He had victory over them. When did he get victory over them? When he was at the cross. And he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. So he nailed all that to the cross, and he won the victory at Calvary. He said the prophecy of Genesis was, he'll bruise his heel, but he will crush his head. Crushing the head is the head of Satan. If I said, I'm going to give you a choice tonight, I can either bruise your heel or I can crush your head. Which would you want? You'll take a bruised heel every time. That you can get along with. A crushed head's a little difficult. All right? And that's life-threatening. Amen? And that's what he pronounced on Satan. Now, 1 John 3 and verse 8. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That's the victory. Jesus had victory over Satan. And just as he had victory over the world and victory over his flesh, he had victory over Satan. And by us being in Christ as believers, that victory is ours. We have that victory. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, please. Notice with me verse 19. Well, we better back up to verse 18, where it says, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. He says, I want you to realize the greatness of the power that's in you. By the way, why? Which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. Far above all, what's the word? Principality. What's the next word? Power. Might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And he hath put all things, where? Under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. He says, listen, he's won the victory according to the great power that's in him, the power that raised him from the dead, and I've raised him up into heavenly places. Where everything, in fact, he's so high, everything's under his feet. Everything is under him. But look at chapter 2 of Ephesians. Verse number 5. Even we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. Quickened is made us alive with Christ. And notice, for by grace are ye saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So he exalted, chapter 1 said he's put Christ up in that high place and everything is underneath him, but he's not alone up there. Who else is up there? We are. That's where we're supposed to be. That's positionally where we are. That's practically where we're supposed to live. We're supposed to understand we have that authority because of Jesus Christ. That victory was imputed to us, or charged the account of us, or attributed to us. At salvation, listen to me, church, at salvation, you were set free from the power of Satan in your life. You no longer have to be under his control. Acts, let me read to you Acts 26 and verse number 18. The Bible says to open their eyes and to turn them from the darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sin and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. When you get saved, you turn from the power of Satan unto God. And you're now under his power and his control. Through my walk with Christ, I maintain my legally purchased freedom. Through my walk with Christ, I maintain my legally purchased freedom. Now, what does that mean, my walk with Christ? Let me help you what that means. Number one, it means I must submit to God and resist the devil. And if I don't do the first one, I'll never do the second one. I'm going to do it much good. If I don't submit to God, I won't have any resistance for the devil. Number two, I must not give ground to Satan by yielding to my flesh. Ephesians 4:27. Remember, neither give place to the devil. I'm giving up ground when I yield to the flesh. I'm giving the devil a foothold in my life. Number three, I must put on the whole armor of God. That's stressed several times in Ephesians 6. Number four, I must desire to walk in the Spirit. For the Bible says, if I walk in the Spirit, I'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now, what does it mean to walk in the Spirit? It means I'll not accuse other people judgmentally. And this goes back to 2 Corinthians 2 when Paul had dealt with this in 1 Corinthians 5 about immorality in their church. And there was a fellow who'd been immoral, and he said, you need to judge that guy, and you need to deal with that sin in the church. Well, they dealt with it, and the fellow had repented, and the fellow had asked forgiveness, but they didn't want it, they still didn't want to forgive him. Didn't want to let him back in. And so he deals with that, says, don't you get judgmental in what you do. Number two, he said, not disobeying the known will of God. When I walk in the Spirit and I'm going to be led by the Spirit, I can't not disobey God. Well, I know God wants me to do this, but. Well, I know the Bible says this, but. Then I'm not walking in the Spirit. I'm looking to disobey what the known will of God is. See there, I need to make sure my testimony is consistent. Make sure my testimony, that's what 1 Timothy 3:7 said. Remember, you must have a good report of those that are without. That's your testimony. So your testimony needs to be consistent or you'll fall into the snare of the devil. And then the next one is I have to avoid a striving, contentious spirit. There, that passage in 2 Timothy is the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men. Apt to teach. Listen. Before you ever do battle against the devil and the forces of evil, you have to be secure of your position in Jesus Christ. We are in Him and we are seated in the heavenlies, far above principalities and powers. See, we have that place of authority. Now, I don't have the authority. In Christ, I have the authority. And I rebuke the devil, not as I rebuke the devil, but in the name of the Lord Jesus, I rebuke the devil. They understand. You'll find this out next week as we talk about facing Satan's kingdom and fighting his soldiers. Is they understand authority. They understand that. In fact, if you remember when we talked about the maniac, when they asked Jesus to go into the swine, they didn't ask Jesus to go into the swine. They said, we adjure thee by God. Let us go into the swine. Why were they appealing to God? Because that's Jesus' authority. They knew that Jesus didn't have any obligation to do what they want. But he does have an obligation to do what God wants. And so they appeal to his authority. And so you have to make sure that you appeal to the authority that we have in Jesus Christ. And we'll get into that, battling those forces of evil, and we'll get into talking about how Satan and his enemies can allow and they exert pressure upon us. And sometimes they get us into those snares and we're taken captive by him. Even as believers, we're taken captive by him. And what you can do about that. I can recognize if that's the situation you're in and what you can do about it. All right? And we'll start that next Wednesday night. All right. Let's stand together for a word of prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for our position and our union that we have with Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, that he has a name that is above every name. And at that name, every knee shall bow. Not only of things in heaven, but things in earth and things under the earth. Lord, we're thankful for the victory that we have through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I pray, Lord, that we would understand when you saved us, that we were saved from the power of Satan unto God. And now we're under your control. Lord, don't help us to submit ourselves to you and resist the devil, and he will flee from us. Give us victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil this week. Lord, watch over us now as we go our separate ways, and make us mindful you go with us, and make us mindful who we are in Jesus Christ and where we are seated with you in heavenly places. And help us live up to our standing. And we'll thank you for it. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Let's sing Higher Ground. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. By faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. God bless you. You are dismissed.